Good evening, everyone. Thanks so much for taking out the time and being on the show today. We have a very interesting topic today. I know during this lockdown, a lot of us have been missing the box office. And we thought, why not get box office and investing together? So we have with us Radhika, CEO of Edelweiss Mutual Fund. Radhika actually does not need an introduction. But for some of you, I'll share a few things about her, which probably you would not know. One is, the most interesting point is we are neighbors, jokes aside. Besides that, Radhika has actually lived across four continents. So, it's a very diverse experience that she brings. She's also worked in various formats, right from a startup to being the CEO of Edelweiss to being part of Wall Street. So probably she's seen it all. And, while you may feel that, okay, someone who's got so much experience, having done so many things, I think Radhika is still below 40. So guys, for a lot of us, she's a real inspiration. And, I would encourage each one of you. She's got a video on YouTube called The Girl with the Broken Neck. I would say, it's a real, real inspirational story about her. All of us should watch it. I watched it for the first time. I have forwarded it to all my friends. And I would encourage you to see it as well. So Radhika, over to you. I think it's a very interesting topic. I'm equally excited to learn more about it. So please, tell us how box office and what we can learn about investing from box office.
So hello, everyone. Thank you, Anand, and the entire FISDOM team. And thank you to those of you who have tuned in. Wishing you a very happy Friday. Thank God it's Friday, although in the lockdown, we can't seem to tell the difference between Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. I am just going to take a second to share my screen. Give me one second to just do that. You should now be able to see my screen clearly. And as Anand said, the title of this presentation is Box Office Investing. There are a lot of things that we've quite managed to get through in the lockdown. We started doing Zoom calls instead of dealing with our colleagues in meetings. We've started learning how to cook on the web. We've started doing Zoom birthday parties. I attended a Zoom Sangeet. But the one thing that we still really miss is, of course, the joy of going to a theater and the magic of the box office. And it's not quite the same seeing the movie release on Amazon Prime and making bad popcorn at home. I mean, at some level, you want to go to the box office and pay for the overpriced popcorn and the overpriced parking at Phoenix Mills. So I think that's something that all of us miss. And that's why today's presentation is about box office investing. Now, why did I choose this topic, box office investing, and what is box office investing? Well, I love the box office. Outside of being an investment professional, one of the businesses I love, I like watching movies, but more than watching movies, I actually love the business of the movies. I think it's one of the most fascinating businesses in the world. And well before there was all this controversial stuff about the film industry floating around, I think it's one of the largest industries of India, great brand ambassador for India. And that's what this presentation is about. This presentation also does not require you to be a movie buff. It's actually not about filmy scenes and filmy dialogues. It's about the business of the movies, the business of the box office. And hum log is dhande se kya seekh sakte hain ki jo cinema ka box office ka business hai, hum log isse kya seekh sakte hain. And I'll try to keep a mix of thoda sa Hindi, thoda sa English in this presentation so that it works for everybody. Now, box office queue. What does box office have to do with bull markets and bear markets? So I think if you think about, agar aap film business ke baare mein soche, so films have a lot of similarity as a business to money. For one, if you think about films, films have size. I think very similar to the fact that the stock market is a large market. It's not a small niche industry. Films have size. And films are a gamble. They are a risk-taking business. In fact, if I could ask you on the chat window, what is the element of risk and return in a film? Well, the risk in a film is the budget of the film. You usually spend some amount of money when you make a film, chahe wo 20 crore ho, 50 crore ho, 100 crore ho. You spend money to make a film. And the more the budget, the higher the risk. So films have risk, just like investments, just like equity has more risk and debt has less risk. High budget films have more risk, low budget films have less risk. Films also have returns. Now, how are those returns earned? And we all love returns. Those returns are earned when there are ticket sales at the box office. these days, returns in films are also earned in other ways. When you sell the music of the film, when you sell the movie film to Netflix or Amazon, or when you sell the film in overseas territories. So just like investments have different source of returns, just like when you invest in equities, there is some return you get from equity growth. There's also some return you get from dividend. So films also have different sources of returns. So just like, films are investments, films is a risk return business. The second interesting thing about the film industry is that there is no formula for a hit film, and success is very, very sentiment driven. I think if you talk to, and I happen to have a couple of friends of mine who are film producers, there is no predictive formula for, you know, when a film will do well. It's very, very similar to the market in that sense. I mean, in the short term, market is also moved by sentiment and liquidity. Success in a film is largely a function of sentiments. And just like markets, success in films and success at the box office is unpredictable. In fact, once upon a time, there was a management guru. I think his name was Arindram Chaudhary. Now he's disgraced in some other format. But he actually tried to make a film based on a formula. Ki agar main ye quant formula apply karunga, you know, I'll get these kind of actors and I'll make this theme and see if you could actually have a film that you could predict and model and make. And obviously, it was an absolute disaster. Films are a sentimental business. The third thing that I find very interesting about the business of the box office is that everybody has an opinion on it. Just like money management, I think today everybody has an opinion on mutual funds, and everybody has an opinion on the stock market. Everybody has an opinion on the bond market. Everybody has a different opinion on films. And it is very, very diverse. I think just like investing is very personal, films are also about pleasing the length and breadth of the country. And all of us know that India is a country where the length and breadth of the country is very different. In fact, you go 100 kilometers and you'll see something very different culturally. So films have a lot of similarities to investing. So today what I'm going to share with you is just like, you know, in the 90s, you would remember, and I was a 90s kid, they used to have these top 10 box office countdowns, and, you know, they would do 10, 9, 8, 7. So I'm going to share with you 10 big takeaways that I think we can take from the big screen. So the first takeaway I want to tell you is about box office collections. And what I'm going to do is, main aapko teen picturein dikhaungi, and I'm going to show you their first week box office collections. In picturon mein kitna paisa aaya tha pehle week mein. And if anyone follows films, obviously the first week of a film is the biggest week in a film. So these are three films and their box office collections. These are recent films, Kick, Bang Bang and Tube Light. If I were to ask you, and their first week box office collections are very large, 150 crores, 107 crores, 106 crores. Three films with very, very large first week box office collections. I'm going to show you another set of films now and their first week box office collections. These films are Three Idiots, Uri and Padman. And you can see their box office collections are significantly less, 60 crores, 70 crores, 79 crores. Which of these films, categories of films, went on to become hits in the long run? Well, actually, it's not the top. It is the bottom. Anyone who's followed anything about the film industry will tell you that Padman, Uri and Three Idiots went on to be far more successful films than the films at the top. However, not as many people came in to see them, and they're broadly in the same time zone. And I think this tells us one very important lesson that we often forget in investing. And it is that you don't have to chase what everyone else does, because neither the flow determines the success of a film. The first weekend box office doesn't determine the success of a film. In fact, many films have had very poor first weekend box offices and still gone on to do very well. So that doesn't determine anything. And the same thing is true in money. Now what I've shown you here is the money example. So this is the investing example. This shows you the net equity mutual fund flows. That is the gray line. And the black line shows you the Nifty return. In years like FY 2000 and at the end of 2008, there was a huge amount of money that came into the equity market. However, if you look at the black line, actually people didn't make very much money. The same is true of recent years. So you don't have to, as an investor, chase the trend where everyone is putting money. I'll give you a very interesting example. You know, we have a fund called Edelweiss Greater China Fund. It's been around for the longest time, and no one has put money into the fund for years and years, but the fund has done extremely well. Now that the fund has done extremely well, of course, everyone is putting money into the fund. It's one of our highest selling funds. And that is true. That is behavioral science. We all want to go where everyone else is going, but where everyone else is going is not necessarily the place to go in the long term. In fact, wo saal jab market kharab karta hai, jaise 2008 ho ya 2011 ho, jab market kharab karta hai, they are often the best years for us to invest. So it is more important for you to focus on the quality of the film you are watching or the quality of the investment you are making, rather than aur log kya kar rahe hain, log kya kar rahe hain, log kya dekh rahe hain, in the long term doesn't matter. The second thing I want to tell you, and this is very relevant in light of this whole multi-cap discussion jo aajkal ho raha hai, is a little bit about a budget. A friend of mine who's an Oscar-winning producer, Guneet Chadha, told me that the single most common reason that films fail is budget. Now, these are two films that you know. They are called Jagga Jasoos and Chef. Agar main zyadatar logon se poochungi, they haven't seen these films. And it makes sense because these films didn't do very well. But they were made on very, very large budgets. If you look at Chef, which is a film that stars Saif Ali Khan, it's half in English. It's a very niche kind of concept, etc. If you look at Jagga Jasoos also, ye aisi picture nahi hai jo broadly logon ko appeal karegi. Lekin because... And शायद अगर ये पिक्चर छोटी बजट पे बनाई जाती तो इनका कुछ हो सकता था, बट बिकॉज दीज फिल्म्स वर मेड ऑन सच अ लार्ज बजट, दे वर अ डिजास्टर फ्रॉम डे वन, दे वर टू बिग टू फेल. इफ यू लुक एट टू अदर फिल्म्स एट द बॉटम, एंड दीज फिल्म्स चांसेस आर एटलीस्ट कहानी मोस्ट पीपल हैव सीन. One of the reasons that these films did very well is they were made on very, very small budgets, 8 crore budgets, 9 crore budgets. And every film has a right budget. Similarly, by the way, in investing, every fund has a right size. Sometimes the reason funds fail is also size, just like budget in films. So film mein budget dekhna bahut zaruri hai, fund mein size dekhna bahut zaruri hai. One of the things that the last 1 year taught us, that one thing that is very important is liquidity. When you invest in mutual funds, you invest with the promise ki agar aap mujhe aaj paise denge and you put in a redemption request, you should be able to redeem your money and you should be able to do it without having an adverse impact. So humne thoda sa analysis kiya, and this is before the whole multi-cap nonsense started, around mid-cap funds. So aapki screen pe you are going to see 13 mid-cap funds. We've not put their names. And we have just done an analysis that if there were redemptions in these funds and I had to liquidate these portfolios, how many days would it take to liquidate these portfolios? Now, if you look at fund 6 and fund 7, look at fund 7. That's very interesting. Fund 7, 50% of the portfolio will take more than 20 days to liquidate. This is a real problem. In fact, there is one mid-cap fund out there where I think it will take 1100 days to liquidate that fund. So it is very important when you look at your equity and debt funds to look at liquidity closely. This is the reason a lot of small, responsible AMCs take the step to close funds like small cap funds and mid-cap funds at a certain size, because ek size ke baad, if a fund gets too big to fail, chances are it will fail. Aap log redemption request dalenge, kuch hoga, and you will not be able to sell the stock in the market. So the second lesson from the film industry that is very, very valuable is, please do look at liquidity. Aap debt fund mein bhi liquidity dekhiye, equity fund mein bhi liquidity dekhiye. And liquidity is a statistic. Mera manna hai ki log fact sheet padh ke nahi dekhte hain. लिक्विडिटी जो है एक स्टेटिस्टिक है जो फैक्टशीट्स और प्रेजेंटेशंस में होती है. जैसे हम अपने एक्विटी फंड्स में लिक्विडिटी की चार्ट आपको देते हैं. सो यू मस्ट आस्क क्वेश्चंस अबाउट लिक्विडिटी. द थर्ड थिंग, एंड आई वांट टू आस्क यू दिस, एंड इफ यू हैव आंसर्स यू कैन पुट देम ऑन द चैट विंडो, इज दैट इन फैशन एंड फिल्म्स एंड बिजनेसेस लाइक दीज देयर आर ऑल काइंड्स ऑफ ट्रेंड्स एंड द ट्रेंड्स कीप चेंजिंग. So if I asked you, what was the big trend in films in the 70s? Chances are you would say it was action films. It was the era of Amitabh Bachchan, The Angry Young Man, Vinod Khanna, etc., etc. Action films were the order of the day. Then something happened. And I think through the 70s and 80s, this trend continued. In fact, Rishi Kapoor, who's late Rishi Kapoor, one of my favorite actors, said that he actually was born into the film industry at the wrong time because he was a romantic hero caught in a time when the trend was only action. But then in late 1989, a film came across and it completely changed this whole action trend. And we moved to a trend of romance. That film was Qayamat Se Qayamat Tak, and it was followed by films like Maine Pyar Kiya, Hum Aapke Hain Kaun, then DDLJ, etc., etc. All this happened. And bahut time tak romantic filmon ka trend chala. This continued even through 2000s, and you know, from romantic films, it became these NRI films and these Dharma films. Then the trend changed again. And films like Wanted, and Wanted, I think, was the one that really changed this trend, brought these drama action films back into vogue. But these were not the Amitabh Bachchan ones. These were these comedy, drama, action kind of things. And it continued with Dabang, etc. for some time. If I ask you what the current trend is, there are two current trends. One is biopics. And so you've seen a lot of biopics, everything from Bhag Milka Bhag to Gunjan Saxena, to har banda ab jaake biopic bana raha hai. And if I ask you a very recent other trend that Akshay Kumar has pioneered, it is the socially responsible film. Now, movie makers who are successful catch the trend early. If you are the last guy to make a drama action film, chances are you will fail. But if you realize the pulse of the audience, that the audience's trends are changing, and you are the first guy to make Qayamat Se Qayamat Tak or Maine Pyar Kiya, and you can catch the trend early, you will have disproportionate upside. So it is very important to know that trends change, and you can't blindly keep following the trend forever. You have to capture the opportunity. Now, trends also happen in the stock market. This is a chart of small caps, and we had launched a small cap NFO about 2 years ago. And for a long time, since about January 18, small caps have significantly been underperforming mid and large caps. But there came a time when the underperformance of small cap relative to mid and large cap has become historic in size. Now, at some point, this trend has to reverse. And now a trend reversal has started in that. And the trend reversal started a little bit because of the SEBI circular and a little bit because markets are changing, or it started because of Robinhood investors, but a trend reversal started. So it's very important, if you want to make disproportionate money, to realize when an out of favor theme suddenly becomes an opportunity. And I think there are a few ways that you can understand when a trend is changing and when there will be interesting opportunities for you. I'll give you a few tips here. One is, please look, which is the opposite of what we do, at when past returns are low. Pharma funds, for instance, which are a very popular theme now, have been a dragger for the longest time. 3 years ago, I remember there used to be a category called multi-asset funds, and everyone used to bash the fact that it's gold, and gold is dragging multi-asset down. Now everybody wants to buy gold. So anytime past returns of an asset class are low, you might know that the trend is changing. The second thing that you should look at is valuations can be below average. That is an important trend to look at. You know, there was a time, I think in late 2013, before Mr. Modi came to power, when companies were trading, like some companies, at least in the small cap space, were trading as if they were nearly bankrupt. When that kind of stuff happens, you know the trend will change. And finally, most importantly, check when the news is negative. When Economic Times is writing, small cap funds have no hope, nothing will happen in small cap, etc., etc., you know that at some point the trend will change because the media is always following the headlines. In fact, this is a quick one to illustrate the point again. What we are showing here is the last 1 year return in small caps. And if you had invested when the news was bad, what the next 5 year return was, and just see the top. When small caps are down 20 to 30% in the last 1 year, you are almost guaranteed to make a lot of money over the next 5 years. But if small caps have been up 20 to 30% in the last 1 year, you're almost guaranteed not to make money over the next 5 years. The fourth thing I want to tell you is about how we love superstars. In India, we love superstars. We love superstars in every domain, whether it is cricket, whether it is the film industry. We just love superstars in every domain. And we think ki agar star hoga, to success guaranteed. These are two films. The first film is Thugs of Hindustan. Chances are most of you have not seen it. Who stars in Thugs of Hindustan? Aamir Khan, Katrina Kaif, Amitabh Bachchan. The movie when Amitabh Bachchan and Aamir Khan came together. Zero. Katrina Kaif, Anushka Sharma, Shah Rukh Khan. Both box office disasters. And the point here is superstars don't guarantee success, only content does. I'm going to tell you a small example of a company called Long Term Capital Management. This is from the book When Genius Failed. Bahut famous failure hai US ka. To ye jo company hai Long Term Capital Management, it was founded by a guy called John Merriweather in 1994. Merriweather was kind of a guru of bond trading, and he was at a company called Solomon at that point in time. He was forced to resign from Solomon after he had some issue with some employee, etc. And then he started building this firm called Long Term Capital Management. At that point, he said he wanted to raise some $1.5 to $2 billion, which in 1994 mein, jab ke bahut bada paisa tha, it was huge amounts of money. And he said that my fees are going to be 25% of profits in addition to 2% of fixed fees, which was absurd at that time. And he said people would have to give me capital for 3 years. So he demanded everything and he was a big name. And this was very uncommon for the industry at that time. So to justify all this, you know, he brought on people who would bring credibility to the firm. He had people like Merton and Scholes, etc. David Mullins, who was vice chairman of the Federal Reserve. And while guys like Warren Buffett rejected him, because he had all these big names in the firm, at that time he launched with $1.5 billion, which was a very, very, very big deal. I mean, a huge big deal. And, you know, the team started and they did reasonably well. And they raised a lot of money. In fact, at some point, Long Term Capital Management was probably about $140 billion in size. They made phenomenal returns. They were earning 28% in a fixed income strategy when other people were either losing money or not making money. However, these guys didn't have any kind of process. They were very, very secretive about their operations. In fact, they were so secretive that banks found it very difficult to work with them. They never told people what strategies they were employing. They used to trade with many different banks to try and not give information to any particular bank. And they didn't say very much. Wo aake webinars, seminars mein, they would give economic information and all, but they would not say very much. And even if media published anything about them, they actually used to get it removed from media. And so this continued for a while. At one point, they had made $2 billion in fees. And two of the partners were actually awarded for the Nobel Prize in 1997. However, Long Term grew too big to fail. And at some point, the size of their positions was so much in things like Brazilian bonds, Russian bonds, etc., that it started scaring people. In 1997-98, the Asian financial crisis happened. And with that crisis, to cut a long story short, they lost billions of dollars in the course of weeks. And finally, they made such a large loss that the federal government, Federal Reserve, had to bail them out, because if they did not bail Long Term Capital Management out, Wall Street would collapse. The moral of the story is the same as the moral of Thugs of Hindustan. You can call this Thugs of the Hedge Fund Industry. Do not fall for brand, credentials, and superstar. Focus on transparency, focus on process. It is better to work with above average people where you know what is going on, it is communicated clearly to you, rather than to just back something with superstars. You know, the most important thing in a film is the script. The most important thing in investments is the process. You know, a good script with superstars will do phenomenally well, but a good script with even average people will do decently well. A good process run by above average fund managers, I think, will do better in the long term than a bad process, because with a bad process, aapko idea hi nahi hai ki aap kar kya rahe. The fifth thing I want to tell you is a little bit about diversification. Now, most of you would have heard of a director called J.P. Dutta. He kept making war films. If you remember the movie Border was actually a reasonably successful movie in the war space. Border successful hui to unhone LOC banai. LOC kam chali, actually nahi chali thi us time pe. Uske baad unhone Paltan banai, jo ki aake chali thi. On the other hand, this is a director called Raju Hirani. He has made very successful films. He could arguably be India's most famous film director. His films have been very many genres. So Munna Bhai was a doctor film. Three Idiots was in the comedy space. And Sanju, as much as I didn't like it, was a biopic. One of the things that's very important is that you can't stay in a single niche. Aapko diversify karna to bahut zaruri hai. Because trends change. Aaj ek time pe border jaisi war film mein chalti thi. Shayad ab wo length ki nahi chalti hai. So you constantly have to diversify in your portfolio, and diversification helps reduce risk. Don't fall for an excessive number of thematic ideas. In fact, what we did in this chart is we showed you seven themes on the left. Infra, income, gold, FMCG, pharma, mid-cap, small-cap. And if you remember, these are all themes of their time. Like, jo meri shaadi hui thi in early 2008, infra was the biggest thing. It was the time I got married on the day of the Reliance Power IPO. Then the debt crisis, the equity crisis happened, and income funds were a popular theme. Then gold, FMCG, etc. Then there was a pharma phase and a mid and small-cap phase. Now, if you had invested in all these themes at the right time, your return would have been 6%. If you had invested in all the niche themes at the right time, your return would have been 6%. However, if you had just bought a simple diversified portfolio, your return would have been 7%. What I'm trying to tell you is that 80% of your portfolio is basics, and it should be basics, because you live in a country where the diversified indexes will only do 8 to 12%. So 20% of your portfolio can be things outside. It's like 80% khana ghar ka khana hi hota hai. Dal chawal hota hai, jo bachpan se khaya hai, wo hi hota hai. 20% can be outside. The sixth thing I want to tell you, and this is something about return expectations, but let me give you the film industry analogy first. So these are three films: Black, Gully Boy, and Urta Punjab. These are all pretty respected films. These were very, very critically acclaimed films. But if you look at all of them, they've done well at the box office, but they were never 200 or 300 crore films. They just never were. And why is that? Because ye fundamentally niche film hai. If you look at Urta Punjab, it is a drug-based film that is not meant for a children's audience. It's an A-rated film. If you look at Gully Boy, something very similar. If you look at Black, while it's a kid-friendly film, it's a film that is largely in English. It is not meant for mass India. And the lesson here from the box office is that every film has a certain potential at the box office. Agar aap ek picture banaoge jisme sare dialogues English mein hai, chances are ke wo mass India mein chalegi hi nahi. Wo 200-300 crore ki picture ho hi nahi sakti, to uska budget bhi kam hona chahiye. Yehi analogy hamari mutual fund industry mein bhi bahut important hai. There are many different categories of funds out there, and here I have put them from low risk to high risk. Equity, savings, balanced advantage, large cap, mid cap, multi cap, and small cap. Now, if you expect that an equity savings fund or a BAF will give you the same kind of returns as a mid and small cap, then you are expecting that Black jaisi picture ka Three Idiots jaisa box office run hoga. Wo ho hi nahi sakta, kyunki Black bahut constrained hai. Aise hi aapka BAF or equity savings fund will not do what a mid and small cap fund will do. In fact, you know, one of the biggest sort of things that irritates me is this whole equity savings fund category. This is a category, I don't know if many of you kisi ne invest kiya hai. It does 1/3 equity, 1/3 debt, and 1/3 arbitrage. एंड द ब्लू लाइन शोज यू द एयूएम ऑफ दिस कैटेगरी एंड द वन ईयर रिटर्न. अब इस कैटेगरी में एयूएम कब आया, पैसे कब आए इस कैटेगरी में. पीपल पुट मनी इनटू दिस कैटेगरी व्हेन इट्स रिटर्न्स वर 14-15%. व्हाट यू सॉ आफ्टर दैट इज इट्स रिटर्न्स एंड द डार्क ब्लू लाइन शोज यू द रिटर्न. इट्स रिटर्न ग्रेजुअली फेल एंड नाउ द कैटेगरी इज डिमिनिशिंग. नाउ हाउ कैन अ कैटेगरी लाइक दिस हैव 14% रिटर्न्स. थोड़ी सी बेसिक मैथ करिए आप. अगर इसमें 1/3 है इक्विटी, 1/3 डेट है, 1/3 आर्बिट्राज है, तो कोई चांस ही नहीं है. इक्विटी आपको 10% देगा तो वहां से आपको 3% मिलेगा. फिक्स्ड इनकम और आर्बिट्राज आपको 6% देगा तो वहां से 3-4% मिलेगा. तो यू कैनॉट मेक मोर देन 6-8% रिटर्न इन दिस कैटेगरी. मे बी 8, मे बी 10. सो वेन यू कम इन एक्सपेक्टिंग 14, यू आर डूम्ड. And I think one of the things to remember is that it is very important to have reasonable expectations in money, just like it's important to have a reasonable estimate of how a film is going to do at the box office. Half the problem that we go through is we expect ki large cap fund 15% return dega, mid cap fund 20% return dega. Wo actually true nahi hai. So sometimes when people ask me, madam, what will the market do? I say you're not going to like this answer, but the answer is 10%. We live in a low inflation and low interest rate environment now. So even pre-COVID, I used to say 10%. So please, there is something called a law of gravity. Have modest expectations. The seventh thing I want to tell you, and this is one of my favorites, is about past performance. Now in Bollywood, there has been a trend to launch sequels. Pehli picture ne achha kiya, to dusri sequel launch kar do. The problem is, just because the first picture did well, the second one doesn't have to do well. These are three sequels which were miserable failures. Once Upon a Time, Mumbai Dobara, Sarkar Raj, which was a sequel to Sarkar, and Total Dhamal, which was a sequel to Dhamal. The first part does not guarantee the success of the second part. And there is a very famous disclaimer that we have in the mutual fund industry called past performance is no guarantee of future returns. To illustrate this point, here are some large cap funds. On the left, you see their rank in 2014, then 15, 16, 17, 18. The fund that was number one ranked in 2014 was 21 in 2016. It's nowhere to be found. The fund that was 28th ranked, the fund that was 28th ranked in 2015 was actually 6th ranked in 2018. So people keep asking, Radhika, what is the best fund to invest in? What is the best fund to invest in? There is no best fund to invest in. You can't time categories. Look at another one. Look at fund that is ranked 3 in 2014. It was ranked 22 in 2018. So trying to predict what will be 1, 2 and 3 doesn't work. And just because something worked last year doesn't mean it will work this year. The eighth thing, and this is a little bit about passive funds, because that's a trend that everybody asks about these days. So, थोड़ा passive की बात करते हैं. अब, when you went to see a picture, and I think ये movie ticket, ये राजकोट का ticket है, ये 1975 की ticket है, तब एक picture का price 3 रुपए होता था. आज की तारीख में ये मैंने हैदराबाद का टिकट पकड़ा है, बॉम्बे दिल्ली का आप भी ले लीजिए, एंड एवरेज टिकट इन अ फिल्म इज 400 रुपीज. प्लस मेनी ऑफ यू हु यूज्ड टू गो टू द थिएटर्स वुड रिमेंबर दैट यू हैव टू पे फॉर पॉपकॉर्न, यू हैव टू पे फॉर फूड एंड यू हैव टू पे फॉर ओवर प्राइस पार्किंग. तो एक फैमिली का बॉक्स ऑफिस जाने का खर्चा कम से कम 4 लोगों का आई वुड से 2000 रुपए से ज्यादा होता है. एज अ रिजल्ट व्हाट हैज हैपेंड इन द फिल्म इंडस्ट्री इज एक्चुअली लेस एंड लेस पीपल आर गोइंग टू थिएटर्स. And Netflix and Prime Video, and even before COVID, have taken over. Now what happens, and a friend of mine who is the CEO of Dharma Productions was telling me that now only a certain kind of film is viable. You know, a film can't just put out content and expect to succeed at the box office. Badi picture hogi, Salman Khan ki picture hogi, kuch experience degi, sci-fi hogi, there's some effects, there's a big screen experience. Then it will succeed at the big screen. But if you're just going to do the same basic thing that you could watch on Netflix or Amazon at home, then nobody is going to pay 2000 rupees at the theater. So as an investor, you have to be thoughtful about the kind of fees you pay. There are places where it is worth paying fees because there is that much alpha out there. It's like there are films you want to see on a big screen, yeah, because you have a big screen experience. But there are things that you could just see on Netflix at home. And there are funds where you could just benefit from the benchmark and go on. This is, in fact, a category which I believe, you know, well before the passive movement happened, has one that has seen significant erosion of alpha over the benchmark. So if you look at the returns of large cap funds, this is the excess return of large cap funds over the benchmark. And as you can see, as large cap funds have become bigger, as the market has expanded, more and more funds have come into play, as regulations have said 80% large cap, alpha has actually come down. We are launching another fund next month, but one of the other categories that is also going to be ripe for disruption is your category of sectoral funds, where I believe alpha has significantly come down. A third one where we experienced this was when we launched something like Bharat Bond, where if you look at fixed income funds, there's actually very little alpha. So as an investor, a lot of people ask me this question on active versus passive, and I really give them the film analog. ऐसी कुछ फिल्में हैं जो आप थिएटर देखने जाओगे. आई रियली बिलीव मिड एंड स्मॉल कैप फंड में आज भी अल्फा होगा. देयर इज लॉट ऑफ स्कोप टू जनरेट अल्फा. एंड ऐसी कुछ चीजें हैं जो आप घर पे बैठ के देख लोगे. परहैप्स योर फिक्स्ड इनकम फंड्स और लार्ज कैप फंड्स आर इन दैट कैटेगरी. Ninth point that I want to tell you is a little bit about blockbusters and small budget movies. Now, everybody thinks that, and I told you that the biggest risk in a film that you take is the budget. But the blockbuster is overhyped. Now, you know, again, I was talking to a friend and he said that when you think of films, what do you think of? 100 crore budget, Sanjay Leela Bansali, badi badi filme, badi badi picture. But actually what makes money more in life is the small budget film. So this is an example from 2018, I think. This is a bunch of films at the box office and this is their budgets. And the right is their return on investment. So risk, return. If you can see, the top three films in terms of return on investments are actually low cost films. So while Sanju and Simba and all these are big 100 crore, etc. films, their return on investment is not very high. Their risk adjusted return on investment is not very high, but the low budget films have very high return on investment. This is also true in our investment industry. I've taken an example of a category I love. And rather than investing in the Nifty, which is volatile, I've taken a category called balanced advantage funds. Obviously, I've used our own. This is a category of funds that invest some in debt, some in equity, and it keeps shifting between equity and debt. Now, it's less glamorous because we say, ki yaar, ye equity debt ka mix, etc., kaun karega? But in the long term, if you look at the bottom, the balanced advantage fund has delivered the same kind of returns as the Nifty, and this is pre-2020. Now it will look better than 2020, but with significantly lower risk, with significantly less heart attacks. So sometimes when you're looking at investments, look at solutions that provide little more downside protection, but longer term upside. The risk reward is in favor. And finally, I want to end with the last piece, which is that even the best in the industry need an advisor. This is a picture, and I know Karan Johar is someone who's been trolled a lot. I don't love his movies, but he's actually one of the most powerful men in the film industry. And the reason he's very powerful is he's also an advisor to a lot of superstars. So sometime a while ago, I think someone asked Kiara Advani or Alia Bhatt this, that why as a superstar do you need an advisor? And they said that no matter how big you become, in fact, the bigger you become, you need someone to give you perspective from the outside. You need someone to tell you, these are the decisions to take, these are the decisions not to take. Ye karna chahiye, ye nahi karna chahiye. I think in every career, and films is just one, ek advisor ka role bahut zaruri hai, aur hamara Edelweiss Mutual Fund mein ye manna hai. And I think no matter how smart you think you are, we all make investment mistakes. I'm going to give you an end with the story of a very famous investment mistake made by someone, but please use the power of advice. So this is a story of Isaac Newton, very famous scientist, mathematician, founder of Newton's laws of motion. And this is how he got stuck in a company called South Sea Company. So Newton bought shares of South Sea Company at £180. स्टॉक डबल्ड एंड ही एग्जिटेड एट 360, फेल्ट वेरी गुड यार, स्टॉक डबल हो गया. उसके बाद स्टॉक चढ़ता क्या? उनके दोस्त लोग अमीर हुए. एंड आमतौर से व्हेन फ्रेंड्स गेट रिच वी फील फोमो. यार वेयर आर वी? फोमो तो 1800s में भी होता था. देन ही रीएंटर्ड द स्टॉक एट 680 बिकॉज ऑफ फोमो. स्टॉक वेंट टू 1050 एंड देन स्टॉक वेंट टू 175 व्हेन ही एग्जिटेड. आफ्टर दिस आइजैक न्यूटन मेड अ स्टेटमेंट कि मैं सितारों के मोशन को समझ सकता हूँ, आई कैन अंडरस्टैंड द मोशन ऑफ द प्लैनेट्स, बट आई डू नॉट अंडरस्टैंड द मैडनेस ऑफ द स्टॉक मार्केट्स एंड द पीपल. एंड दिस इज समवन हु प्रोबेबली हैड अ हायर आईक्यू देन मोस्ट ऑफ अस ऑन दिस कॉल. सो इवन द बेस्ट लाइफ नीड एडवाइस, प्लीज यूज एडवाइस. द लास्ट थिंग आई एम गोइंग टू लीव यू विद एज वी समराइज दिस बॉक्स ऑफिस टॉप 10 इज One of the things that they say in show business is it's the best business in the world. And one of the most famous quotes about show business is there is no business like show business. But there's also a second quote about show business, and that says, remember, no show, no business. So there's no business like show business, but remember, no show, no business. I would tell you the same thing about money. There is no business like the capital markets business, but the capital markets business is about staying invested and taking risks. If you are not invested, there is no return. So my request to you is, in all this volatility, no show, no business. So stay invested. Thank you. Anand, over to you.
Thank you so much, Radhika. I think it's really a Friday well spent, and I think some of the most important lessons that we need to learn about investing, I would say you put it in such a nice way that a lot of us will remember this. The next time we go to watch a movie, I'm sure, we'll recall some of the things that you've said. Radhika, I know we've already spent 40 minutes, but I just like a few questions that were asked. I'd like to get your views on them. You spoke about, that things get back to gravity and there is a time for everything. So there's a question, is it a good time to invest in the small caps? Okay. Small
so
caps
I have funds. Two points to this. It has been a good time to invest in small caps for the last 2 years for the simple reason that small caps and mid caps as a segment have had a historic degree of underperformance relative to large caps. So it's been a good time for 2 years, and at some point this will reverse. Now, unfortunately, Anand, if you were asking me this question a month or two ago, nobody asked me this question. Recently, with small cap performance and the SEBI circular, there is a catalyst, and there's always a catalyst for things. I would say invest in small caps, one, if your asset allocation can afford it, and if you have the risk appetite. I actually tweeted, please invest if you have a 7 to 10 year horizon, and people said, ma'am, 7 to 10 years. Yes, 7 to 10, actually closer to 10. Do not invest because of a circular, because 7 saal mein circular will not make a difference. 7 saal mein fundamentals will make a difference. So invest in the right quantity. Invest because you are ready to lose 50% a year, because it could happen in small caps. And invest because it's a fundamentally good category, not because SEBI put out a circular and small caps will do well for 6 months, which we don't even know if that's true.
So, guys, I think it's a very, very important point. A lot of, people keep asking us as well. I think, mutual funds is not to just make returns in the very short term. In fact, equity investing itself, we should do it for the long term. Given that, small caps and mid caps, are more volatile, more risky than the normal large caps. I think Radhika is absolutely right. Anything below 7 to 10 years, if that's not your horizon, don't try and touch this category. Even if you're thinking of individual stock investing, because it looks very easy to just make money, but when you get stuck, you just can't get out. So please don't try and think, okay, it's a very easy way to make money. It makes money, but you have to be patient. Radhika, the second question, which is a very interesting one, is you spoke about two things, which is don't just go by the brand or the name, okay, or by the actors that are there. And the second is past performance is no guarantee of the future. So someone has asked, then how do you select the right fund? If I can't look at the past performance, or if I can't take a brand saying, okay, this particular fund manager or this particular AMC,
okay,
then
so
how does one select
a fund? Is a sort of long process, but I'll give you a few things that I like to look at when I select funds. And my point was, don't only go by one thing, don't be blinded by things. So obviously you should work with a fund house that is reputable. you know, has been in the business for some time. And you should look at a fund team that has been with the fund house for some time. A fund house, you know, typically when I've seen overseen funds for many, many years, fund managers that have managed the same schemes for a long time, that kind of stability is very good. You should understand what the fund is doing and what success means for the fund manager. Please understand the investment style of the fund manager, when it will do well and when it will do badly, because I guarantee you it will do badly at some point and you will have to live around. The success of your investment will be able to is the ability to ride bad times. So understand the fund house and its values, the longevity of the fund manager. Second, understand the investment process. It's very important to make sure that if you're investing in a mid-cap fund, it is a true-to-label mid-cap fund. It is not holding large caps and doing all this stuff. If you're investing in a short-term fund in debt, it is a high-quality short-term fund. In fact, I think one of the things investors don't look at all is the portfolio. We put out as an AMC industry our portfolio every month on our website. Please look at the whole portfolio. It's the single most important document of a fund. That will help you understand the fund. Do look at performance. Don't look at 1 year performance. That is the most overutilized statistic in the mutual fund industry. In fact, it should be reversed. Look at 5 to 10 year performance, even if you are investing today. And don't look at absolute performance. Look at rolling performance. So what the experience of different investors has been. Also understand the risk profile of a fund. As I said, a mid-cap fund will have a very different profile from a balanced advantage fund. So these are the broad things I think you need to look at. And the last thing I would say is have moderate expectations from a fund. Picture mein dekhne jaate ho, toh you don't expect that every movie you watch is going to win an Oscar, right? You want to have a good experience, right? I mean, that's the outcome. When you invest in a fund, it should do two things. It should beat its benchmark. Otherwise, you should buy an ETF or index fund. Second, compared to its peer group, it should be broadly in the top half over the 3 to 5 year period. That is enough. So that is paisa vasooli in my view in mutual fund investing.
So guys, I think, you know, this is another important point. I think a lot of us fall for it. We have this recency bias, you know, wherein we just look at the last 3 months, 6 months, which is the highest return fund, and, you know, we just choose that. I think, you know, please take an informed decision and choose a fund, not just basis what you see as the recent performance, but a lot of factors and you know, reasons what Radhika pointed out. And it's very important. And last is, you know, what is the purpose that you're trying to achieve? You know, like she said, you know, if you are looking at a balanced advantage fund and you expect a small cap returns, you'll be disappointed, you know, even in the long term. So please have your expectations clear. Radhika, last one is, you know, you spoke about gold funds. And I think, you know, everyone has been talking about gold for some time. So someone has asked, you know, is it a good time to still enter the gold funds as a category or gold as an investment class?
Okay, so I'm going to cover two categories that I get common questions about because the answer is the same even though you asked about gold and international funds. Never in my career have I answered so many questions about gold and international funds. Okay, and my answer is the same. Both very good asset classes. I've been investing in both for a long time, since 2011. Please buy them because they are part of the asset allocation. Do not try to time, it's a good time to buy gold, it's a bad time to buy gold. You will not be able to do that. Do not assume that because gold or international funds have done well for the last year that they are less risky. They have years when they can be negative. So invest in them for the right reasons. Again, sometimes, you know, and I run a very large basket of international funds, but I tell investors this, if you're coming into my international funds thinking, they did well in the last year or in mein risk nahi hai, Indian equities mein risk hai, then you are going to fall flat. You are still investing in equity. It's, in fact, this is true, by the way, Anand, direct equity investors too. Whether you're investing in equity mutual funds, index funds, direct equity, international equity, PMS or AIF, it is still equity. The tool, the route is not going to change. The route can change. The asset class will not change. So the fundamental principles of investing don't change whether it's equity. So whatever asset class, please have the gumption to hold on to it for the long term. That is my only point on gold and foreign equities. And I covered foreign equities because it comes up also.
So Radhika, I think, you know, I keep saying this point as well, that even gold and international funds, as you rightly said, there's a lot of talk about it. End of the day, as asset classes, these are growth assets. And, you know, you don't invest in growth assets with a 1, 2 or 3 year time horizon. For those, you know, you have the fixed income, you know, as a category that you can look at for the short term. Any of these categories, you know, anything that touches equity or it's a commodity. Given gold, you know, you can say it's a commodity. You know, the tenure of investing is extremely important. It may be the flavor in terms of where you can create an alpha, or it should be a part of your portfolio for diversification. But don't come in into it thinking, okay, for the next 6 months, our US equity is going to give better return than Indian equities. And let me try and ride that for 6 months. You know, if your time horizon is 6 months, I think, you know, you can get disappointed whether it's Indian equities or international equities. So let me just see, Radhika, if there are any other important questions that we should ask you. One second.
There's some lovely comments, all of them. So thank you.
Yeah, I think there are more thank yous to you than any question. Radhika, thank you so much. You know, really, really nice to have you. And I think we couldn't have anything better on a Friday evening than this. So thanks so much for your time. And I think, you know, we'll all take back some very, very simple lessons, you know, told to us in a way that we understand, which is through box office. So thank you so much. And thanks for making it so interesting. We've never seen finance being so interesting. So thanks. Thanks once again.
My pleasure. Happy weekend, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.